My name is Vijay Kannan. I am head of the management department in the Huntsman School of Business here at Utah State University. I'm also convening the Lead Educator Summit series of webinars this summer on how we can embrace Lean as a methodology and as a philosophy to incorporate into our classrooms. Some of you may have joined us last month. We heard from Professor Mike Dixon talking about how you might use cases as a teaching tool in the Lean classroom. Next month in July, we will have a presentation on the use of games, again, as a pedagogical tool to facilitate teaching students about Lean principles in the classroom. This morning, delighted to have with us Ken Snyder. Ken Snyder is the executive director of the Shingo Institute here in the Huntsman School of Business. Ken has been with us here in the school now for 13 years. He has been the executive director of the Shingo Institute since 2015. During that time, he has been a tremendous advocate for not just the Institute and for the Shingo Prize, which was the precursor to the Institute, but more broadly for how do we create conversations about Lean, how Lean fits into not just the, not only the industrial world, but also how can we use Lean as a way of educating our students about opportunities to improve operational performance in organizations. Undoubtedly, these last couple of years have been particularly challenging with the pandemic and obviously a lot of people asking questions about Lean and just in time. And how do you reconcile what we've seen in the last 15, 16 months with this very strong desire and need within the Lean community to eliminate waste? That's a conversation for another day. Thrilled to have Ken here with us this morning to talk about how we might use the Shingo model and framework as a vehicle and as a platform for delivering Lean education in the classroom. So before I turn it over to Ken, just a couple of reminders. If you do have questions over the course of the presentation, please do put them into the Q&A area of the webinar. What we will do at the end of the presentation is we'll try to go through those questions. We'll try to get through as many of those as possible. But we will, Ken prefers that we address the questions at the end. So please put them in the Q&A and we'll try to get as many of those done as possible. The second thing I would remind you of is, again, next month, I should have pulled out the date here. I think it's July. Let me just get the date for you to confirm it. July the 9th, I believe it is. July the 13th, we will have the third webinar in this series on Lean gamification by Dr. Ahmed Daif from Cal Poly San Luis Obispo. And the third thing I want to remind you of is if you do have ideas for other additional webinars on how we might bring Lean into the classroom, please do reach out to me or to Mary Price, who is also co-hosting on this session this morning. Would love to go ahead and schedule some additional seminars over the course of the summer and beyond. Lots of potential ideas in terms of how we might want to use Lean in the classroom. What we want to do as, you know, the underlying philosophy of the Lean Educators Network is to create a forum, create a space where we can exchange ideas and make sure that, the many participants in the network are familiar with what some of our colleagues are doing and some of the best practices in terms of Lean education. So please do not hesitate to reach out to me or to Mary and let us, we can talk to you about submitting short proposals so we can try to get those on the calendar. But with that, let me stop. Let me turn it over to Ken, and Ken will walk us through the Shingo model as a framework for teaching Lean. Ken, it's all yours.
Thank you so much, Vijay. Yes, what I'd like to do first is talk a little about the Shingo model so that it provides some background, and then talk a little bit about how you might use the Shingo model in your as part of your pedagogical development. There's ways that we think the model could be used, and what I want to do is give you those options and let you know what it is that you can use and how you can use it. But as some background, let me just focus first of all on what is the Shingo Institute and what is the Shingo model. This is the mission statement of the Shingo Institute, is to improve the process of improvement, and we do that by conducting research, by creating educational materials and doing assessments such as the Shingo Prize assessments. And then as part of that assessment process, we also like to recognize organizations that are committed to achieving world-class results. So with that mission in mind, let me provide a little bit of history. We are a program of the John M. Huntsman School of Business at Utah State University. We started in 1988. And let me just tell you a little bit about our namesake. We are named after Shigeo Shingo, and he, in 1988, we invited him to receive an honorary doctorate from Utah State University. And at that time, we asked him for permission to use his name to start the Shingo Prize. What is Dr. Shingo famous for those of you who might not be familiar with him, he is the author of 17 different books in Japanese, of which 7 have been translated into English. The most famous of those books is the green book that you see here on the screen. It is a study of the Toyota production system. It's probably sold more than 10 times as many books as that, and has been translated into, as far as I can tell, 14 or 15 different languages. Shingo was famous for a number of different things that are part of the foundation of Lean as we know it today. He is the person who created the concept of SMED, or single minute exchange of dai. He also developed a term to describe what we now call one-piece flow, but what he called non-stock production, and wrote a book about how that would work. He is the person who he created the word pokioke. They used a different word within Toyota, which he then taught us the word pokioke, which is the word he created for error proofing and so on. There's a lot of things that are part of the Lean lexicon that go back to Shigeo Shingo, and we are indebted to him for his life's work and for the legacy that he left with us. We started the Shingo Prize in 1988, awarded our first prize in 1989. We have had many recipients, which I'm gonna go over just real quickly to just give you some background. These are recent recipients of the Shingo Prize the last couple of years. And I do that with you just to give you an idea of the location of them. If you look, you'll see not very many from North America, but you'll see from places all over the world. And that's been true for several years. I put this list here partially because these are some of the organizations that we study, and I'll mention some of the research that we've done and how we've conducted it. This is a map showing the extent of Shingo recipients around the world. We now have recipients in over 30 different countries, and the Shingo Prize has truly become a global standard of excellence. It hasn't always been that way. And let me just give you a little bit of the history from the initial Shingo Prize and what happened soon after that. So when somebody did good work, had good lean systems, had good lean tools, and got some good results from it, they received a Shingo Prize. And unfortunately, what happened is many of the recipients were unable to sustain their improvements. And so after receiving a Shingo Prize, we saw a large number of organizations that declined in performance, and only a few who received the Shingo Prize who continued to get better. As one would expect with continuous improvement, you would expect the best to keep getting better. But unfortunately, that wasn't the case. And so we wanted to understand why. And let me just kind of walk you back. This is the model that we used during the early years of the Shingo Institute. Good systems, good tools, good results got you a Shingo Prize. But we found that there's something missing here. And the question is, what's missing? And one way that it's been described is that I thought resonated well was too many organizations did lean to their people with their systems and tools and got some good results on a temporary basis. But the ones that were able to sustain their improvements were the organizations that did lean with their people. They engaged their people and they changed the culture of the organization. And we thought it was kind of interesting that so many people we talked to said, you know, that we just never had the culture, or those that kept getting better and better would say, we just created a culture of excellence. And what do we mean by culture? We found that there's some organizations, but even those that failed to sustain their improvements, we found that they talked about the culture. They had the same values on the wall that those that did sustain, and they had the same sort of discussions, but they didn't engage their people. And so there's a question of how do you measure culture? How do you observe culture? What is culture? And we found that the best way that we could describe that was the behaviors of the people in the organization. Don't tell us what you believe in. Don't show us what your value statement. Show us what you do. Let us see what you do. And so that became an important part of us rethinking the Shingo model. We love to do this little exercise, and I'm not going to do it right now with the whole group, but look at different descriptions of culture and what kind of behaviors you might expect. So for example, in a power-hungry culture, those who are gathering power and using power in ways to drive something in their organization, that's a power-hungry culture, and you see people being promoted because they're able to assemble power together and so on. One of the things that I love to talk about is firefighting. I see a lot of organizations that are in firefighting mode all the time. The best firefighters are the people who get promoted. They therefore create more fires so that they can be the hero that solves the fires and so on. This is not the kind of organization that drives excellence. The best organizations avoid fires. They figure out ways so fires don't happen. They make sure everything goes smoothly so you don't have to have firefighting. We find the best organizations, and I'll just pick out one topic here, trust, because there is a certain speed around trust. And to the extent that people can trust one another and believe what they say, they can act on that. And you see behaviors based upon them acting on that trust, as opposed to being told to do something, but then I don't trust what that person says. I don't know if they're trying to influence me or gain power or whatever. And so they don't act on it. And you can see that also. It's observable, the behavior that comes with trust or comes from the lack of behavior that comes from not trusting. And so we can predict behaviors based upon the description of what it is. So in the research that we did, we looked at all of the organizations that had received a Shingo Prize over the first 15 years, roughly, of the prize. And in doing that research, it was really a bunch of case studies. It wasn't a controlled research methodology, but it was a bunch of case studies. But we did find some common themes. And so we put those themes into insights because they drove our development of the Shingo model. The first thing we noticed when we were talking to the organizations that kept getting better, even after receiving a Shingo Prize, is they would say things like, oh, we don't look at KPIs anymore. We look at people's actions. We look at people's behaviors. And one example of one organization that we documented was about safety. It's a manufacturing organization where they're required to report, located in North America. So they're required to report to OSHA all accidents and all lost time due to accidents. So those are reportables to them. And they said things like, well, of course we have to track reportables because we have to submit the report to OSHA. But we don't focus on that. We focus on near misses and how we make sure that we take action so that those near misses never turn into a safety accident. We also have safety issues that people report, and we track the number of implementations of how do we prevent that safety issue from creating a situation that could cause an accident. So we've tracked behaviors of preventing accidents. We don't track after the fact the lagging indicators of how many people were hurt. And of course, if we track the right kinds of behaviors, what happens is the number of accidents go down and the number of days missed go down. So we feel like we're doing a better job of driving excellence because we're making the work safer because we're preventing accidents from happening. And that's just an example of what we mean when we say ideal results require ideal behaviors. The second insight from our research was that purpose and systems drive behavior. We found a lot of people would be really excited to come to work and do great work if they understood the purpose of the organization and they bought into it. They were united around it. And I'll talk about an example of what that means in a little bit later. But people would really do the right thing, that do the right behavior because they believed in the purpose and they understood what it was. But the other thing that we found is that if leadership does not make it easy for people to do the right thing, in other words, they still have to do something hard to be able to do the right thing, over time, they'd quit doing that ideal behavior and they'd go back to the behavior the system drove, because it says things like, oh, management doesn't really care. Otherwise, they would make it easy. And so what do we mean when systems drive behavior? How do systems drive behavior? Systems should make it easy to do the right thing and make it hard to do the wrong thing. And let me just give you an example that we observed at Toyota. This is a Toyota assembly line. I've drawn a red arrow where it shows a little puck on top of the vehicle that's going through the assembly line. That tells the whole system, the integrated computer network system and database, which car this is, which order it is, what are all the specs on it, and so on. That same system is integrated with every bin that the workers might draw parts out of. So when this vehicle comes up, the worker goes to get the part, which is, you can see kind of the different bins over here, and there's also bins on the other side. So but the bin will light up and with a green light saying, this is the bin to pull the part out of. The other bins will have a red light on them. If the worker happens to accidentally open the wrong bin, the red light starts beeping, you know, it starts flashing at them and saying, this is the wrong bin. And the green bin is still lit up so that the worker can look around and go, oh, I'm supposed to get the part out of that bin. It makes it easy for this particular team member to do the right thing because there's a green light, and to do the wrong thing because there's a red light. And if you happen to go to the point of actually making a mistake, which we all have the capability of doing, the system will make it easy for him to see that mistake, makes it hard for him to do the wrong thing, makes it easy for him to do the right thing. So that to us is an example of how systems drive behavior. Now, when we talk about systems, though, we have found that it's a really confusing term to use. There's lots of different meanings that can possibly be associated with systems. And so we found it necessary to define what a system is in a way that is very applicable to organizations and how they use systems to drive excellence. Dr. Deming was one of the examples of people who use the term system a lot. He said this in spite of the fact that management is responsible for the system or lack of it. I find in my experience that too few people know what constitutes a system. And then he proceeded to not say what constitutes a system. This is from his book, his original book. His follow-up book, though, that he wrote several years later, The New Economics for Industry, Government, and Education, he actually came up with a definition of this, of a system, which we use in our definition as well. A system is a network of interdependent components that work together to try to accomplish the aim or purpose of the system. The aim of the system must be clear to everyone in the system. So what we found through our research is that we have found within organizations three different types of essential systems. You can organize other things, and we've seen lots of organizations that organize them in different ways. But we have found that there are work systems, the systems that get the work done, the work that adds value, the work that you sell to your clients or your customers. There are systems that help support those, and we call those improvement systems. They help make the work better or easier. These are things like training systems or onboarding systems. These could be idea suggestion systems or things like that. And then there are management systems, things that allow the organization to run. So these could be strategy development, strategy deployment. These could be a budgeting system and things like that. One thing that is important to understand is all systems within the organization are networked and are interdependent, and that every system should have a couple of required components. First of all, an aim or a purpose, something that what is the system supposed to accomplish? Each system should also have an owner. And there are a set of tools that we have found that are need to be part of every system in order for that system to function properly. And we've put those five different required tools. You can have more tools in your system too, but there are five that we have found have to be within every system in order for it to function properly. There needs to be standard work. What is the standard for the system? How do you do this? Like if it's a purchasing system, how do you implement a purchase order and get it approved and get it ordered and so on? There's a reporting structure of what exactly are we supposed to be doing? Are we doing that? There's feedback, some sort of feedback system back to the owner and to management of, is the system actually doing what it's supposed to be doing? There is a schedule or a cadence of activities within the system that make the system run. And there is an improvement log. This is as you make improvements, as you change things, as you change the standard work, you should document the new standard work so you don't revert to bad habits that have may have existed in the past that you're trying to correct and so on. Okay, systems. The third thing that we learned from the research we did in studying the organizations that kept getting better, especially after receiving the Shingo Prize, is they could always describe why they were doing something. And we noticed some very, very consistent themes, and we organized those themes into principles. And these principles inform ideal behavior. They answer the question, why are you doing that? And so we use the term principle, and partly because of the work of Dr. Stephen R. Covey, one of our former colleagues at the Huntsman School, who taught that a principle is a foundational rule that has an inevitable consequence. And there's three important components to every principle. One is it's universal and timeless, meaning it's true throughout time. It's true everywhere you go in the world. It's evident in that you can discover them through, and you can see the consequence. You can document the consequences of those principles. You can create evidence to support those principles. And that there are consequences. And I'll just use a simple principle, not a principle of organizational excellence, but I'll just choose gravity as a principle. It's universal, it's timeless. No matter where you are in the world, things still fall. You can watch them fall. There is evidence you can create of them falling. And there are consequences. If I decide that I can fly, it doesn't matter what I decide, gravity still takes over and I'll go splat if I decide if I can jump out of an upper story window and think I can fly. It doesn't matter what I think, the consequence is still the same. And so we can look at the consequences of the different actions people take and according to principles, and we can create evidence to support the principle. So we developed a set of guiding principles. We organized them into different dimensions because for ease of understanding. We find that those around cultural enablers really address the people aspect of an organization. The ones that are about process are how do you improve that? How do you improve the organization? And they are guided also by the purposes of the organization. We have 10 different principles. I'll spend a little bit more time on this in just a minute, but we've organized them into this format, and it's an important part of our model. Last month, Professor Dixon shared with you the O.C. Tanner case study that he wrote. We have a video that we did in conjunction with O.C. Tanner a few years ago about how they use the Shingo model principles to influence behaviors. And it features Gary Peterson. The rights to this video, I should note, are owned by O.C. Tanner as part of the agreement we had in developing the video with them. And they have had it posted on their website the last couple of years. So I believe it is public domain and available for you to use if you want to use it in a class setting. But let me just show you the video and enjoy.
This is our strategy wall, and it helps communicate the way we show our people what really matters and what they can do to contribute to the overall well-being of the company. And it all starts with the principle statements. These are the principles that we've gotten from the Shingo model, which means an awful lot to us, We put them up here in the white words, and these are the principles that our people really connect with. Lead with humility, respect every individual, assure quality at the source, seek perfection, create constancy of purpose, those kind of ideas. These are bedrock for us. And in the black letters here, we've kind of written a description of what we mean by the principle. And I'm convinced that you go on the floor, you talk to any employee here. I don't know that they necessarily rattle off the principles. You talk to them about respecting individuals, they'll know what you're talking about. And they'll feel about it the way that we've written about it here. And we try to reinforce this because again, we find this is foundational to all of the things that happen. So having the principles, then we decide, well, what is it that we need to have in place in the teams, on the floor, throughout our organization, so that we can support these principles. And that's where we come up with the systems, creating the systems. Like we have a coaching and training system. Not surprisingly, the coaching and training supports this idea of respecting individuals. It teaches people how to embrace scientific thinking. It helps them understand the importance of seeking perfection, reinforces constancy of purpose. All the different systems help us accomplish the principles. That's why they exist.
So great video. Let me just quickly go through the 10 different principles that are part of the Shingo model. Cultural enablers, we have two different principles. The first is respect every individual, and the second is lead with humility. We have what we call supporting concepts that support these principles, and I'll just go back to the one I gave an example of before. Assure a safe environment is, we find, a prerequisite to being able to develop a culture of excellence. If you don't have a safe environment, people are worried about their safety, and they're not worried about improving the organization. But it's reflected in the principle, respect every individual. You respect them, and therefore you create a safe environment for them. That's an example of what we mean by a supporting concept. In the second dimension, the continuous improvement dimension, we have five principles: seek perfection, embrace scientific thinking, focus on process, assure quality at the source, improve flow and pull. We could spend a lot of time on all of those, but I think for purpose of going forward and making sure you get a good overview, let's just go through these others. And then I want to give you an example of how another organization puts these together. In the enterprise alignment dimension, we have three principles. Think systemically, not systematically, but think of the whole system. This is systems thinking. Create constancy of purpose and create value for the customer. Now, one of the benchmark organizations that we studied in our research project is an organization that has multiple Shingo Prize recipient units within the organization is a company called Autoliv. They are an auto parts supplier. They make primarily airbags. That's their main product line. So this is a video about the facilities that make the airbag, and it shows an example of how creating constancy of purpose and how people rally around that purpose to drive excellence within their organization.
Here at Autoliv, understand that we are in the perfection business. We get paid for saving lives. We make life-saving devices that every day are the difference between someone being able to walk away from an accident and maybe not so. And so when we look at what drives improvement, we need to look at sustainable improvement, because we're talking about perfect performance every day. And every day we challenge ourselves to be better than we were the day before. How do you do that? You do that by reaching deep in people and by linking with values that drive their behavior. And the basis for those kind of values are principles. We try to grab one of those principles, and we embody it in our motto that we save lives. Every day we come to work and we save lives. We're in a very tough business. In the automotive business, if you don't improve, you don't exist. With every person that comes in that door, we have these multi-dimensional capabilities. And our job as management is to create and sustain the environment that fosters those abilities to be expressed, expressed as improvement ideas, expressed as them developing their workplace so that it is owned by them. Now, in a role as one of our top managers, my job is that we keep focusing on those things that will sustain our ability to add value over time in a better way. In business schools, you might be told, you have to drive lower costs by lower overhead or lower labor costs or lower material costs. Well, all those are great, but you don't do those directly. You do those through investing and raising the skill and the ability of your people. And if you do that and do it well, then they do all those things and they do them better than you would know how to do because it's their house, it's their job, and they do it very well. So as management at Autoliv, our job is to hold up those principles that sustain their behavior on a daily basis. And as we do that, as we are seeking perfection through employing their ideas every day in the workplace, by showing that we trust them by implementing their ideas, we are then in a position to accomplish the goals of the business, save more lives every day by implementing the ideas of our people. And by doing that, we all win. You can operate in the short term by just pursuing results. And you can get results in the short term, but it's a sugar high. It doesn't last. It's not sustainable. And so what it degenerates into is a program, just another program. But the way we do it, through investing in our people and sustaining the culture that we have, by doing that, we invest in our future. We invest in the future of our people, and we grasp that future and make it our own. Basing improvement on principles is a long-term perspective. It is looking beyond the horizon. Basing improvement on anything other than principles is by its very nature finite. It cannot sustain itself in the long term. I measure success by the light in their eyes. When you see the spirit through the eyes, and that spirit is dynamic and vibrant and on fire, what else do you need to see?
So I'm going to use some terms right now to kind of put this all together. We in the lean world have had a history of teaching know-how or know-what, things like how to run a Kanban system or how to set up a 5S system or something like that. And we find that the Shingo model and it helps people to understand the know-why. And the why are those principles that we talked about, those guiding principles of respect every individual, safety first. And the why is because we respect every individual. We want you to be safe. We want you to be engaged at work. We don't want you to have to worry about your safety while you're here at work. We want you to worry about how we can make the job that you're doing better. And the thing, same is true about improvements. We want we teach people how to submit a card of an improvement idea. But we want them to improve the whole organization, not to improve their own little part of it, their own piece of it. That what we want is them to understand the whole system so that they can understand how the whole system can can be impacted, and so on. It's important for people to know why, and if they understand the why, they understand how to do things better, and they understand what things they should do, and they understand that better as well. Shingo taught this a lot. He actually used this in his Japanese language book. He used the terms know-how and know-why. So this is a translation of what he said, but it is not a translation of those terms because he used the English term in his Japanese book. But know-how alone isn't enough. You need to know why. And and one of the examples of where people go to study know-how, but they don't go to study know-why is on all the tours that people take of Toyota facilities around the world. And he says, you visit other plants, but all you do is you copy their tools and methods without understanding the why behind it. And what our goal was in organizing this set of guiding principles was to teach the why. And if you teach the why, then people can understand the what and the how a lot better. This organizing system and developing a standard workaround systems was to help people understand the know-how better, because we find that there's a lot of difficulty organizations have in understanding the how. So those two elements are things that we suggest that you incorporate into your curriculum. I just want to make a few more comments, and then I'll talk about how you can incorporate that into your curriculum, okay? One of the questions I had was the research that we did to develop the model was all case study based research. And I wanted to see to see if the academic research supported it. And about 5-6 years ago, we hired a director of research, Professor Rick Edgman. Rick may be on the call. If he is, shout out to Rick. He has subsequently left and become a department head at Fort Hays State. But during his time at the Shingo Institute, he put together a book called Complex Management Systems in the Shingo Model. What it is a deep dive focused on particularly the principles in the model. And it's a literature search, but it's also a commentary on what he found in all the academic literature. And basically what he said, what he came up with was in going through each of the principles of the Shingo model, that each of them are independently backed by academic research. And the book he has, we make it available. One may call it biased because we sponsored the research and he was working for us at the time, but we wanted to see, is there something that we're saying or something that we're teaching that is not supported by the research? And his conclusion was, no, what we're teaching is absolutely correct. It is a good example of understanding know why. All right, so this is the Shingo model as we use it today. If you remember, the old model was systems, tools, and results. We've added culture, the behavioral piece, and that is guided by the guiding principles. We've expanded the definition and the focus on systems because of the research that we've done on how to make systems work. And yes, so this gets back to, this is supported by research and it does help understand the know why. Now let's talk for just a minute about how can you incorporate the Shingo model in your teaching. First of all, anything that is on our website is you're welcome to use. We have an overview of the model. We have a lot of the materials that I've just reviewed in this presentation available from our website. We also, on our website, if you go to the model tab, you can scroll down and you can download this model booklet. And this model booklet is about 50 pages. It's fairly simple. You can read it in less than maybe a half hour, 45 minutes, something like that. But it's an overview of everything that I've discussed and more in this presentation. This is something we make available free of charge. It is usable within your classroom. So you could download this booklet and send it electronically to all of the students in your classes. The only thing that we ask for if you're using something from our website or using something from the model is give us attribution. Let them know that this comes from the Shingo model or from the Shingo Institute. And that's all we ask is proper attribution. We find that it will help people understand the why and understand the how better. And so please feel free to incorporate this within your curriculum as you see fit. I also wanted to talk just really briefly, another minute or so, about the different research initiatives. I mentioned the research that we did on numerous case studies, both in developing the Shingo model as we use it today and the guiding principles, but then later as we develop the thinking about systems that we have. Those are ongoing case study-based research that we do, where we try to look at the best organizations in the world and learn from them, and then share that with everybody else that we can share it with. We also are involved with a couple of other research things that I thought you might be interested in knowing about. One is we have developed an assessment tool. It's a survey tool where we have organizations, for example, those that apply for the Shingo Prize, but any others that are inclined to want to do that, do an assessment by surveying the employees within their organization. And here's a description of it from our website, the assessment tool. And if you are interested in using the data from this survey tool for any research that you do, please contact us and we'd be happy to have you. We have to do the proper agreements, of course, but if you're interested in using it, we've had one person who's used it as one of the data sets for their PhD. We have another one who is also working it right now on using our data as part of their PhD as well. I also want to talk to you about CLEAR. This is not our initiative, but one which we follow closely, and they kindly let us be involved to the extent that we can. It's a research project that's out of UC Berkeley. It's called the Center for Lean Engagement and Research in Healthcare, and it's the leading academic research being done on lean in healthcare right now. And they have some really fascinating results that they come out with. There's going to be a CLEAR conference in a week and a half from now, roughly a week from Monday. And so if you want to join that, you can go to the Berkeley website, just do a search for CLEAR Berkeley, and you can come up with this website and you can see some of the research that they do. What I really want to encourage you to do, though, is utilize the Shingo model in what you're teaching. And really what I want you to change is help them understand the know why and a little bit more about the know how. And as you do that, I think you can help your students blaze new trails every day. Thanks. And I'm open to questions now. I think Vijay is going to moderate the questions for us and happy to answer it as best I can.
Great. Thanks, Ken. I really appreciate that overview of the Shingo approach. Lots of material there that can be used as a driver of not just, like you said, what we do in a classroom, but why we should do it that way. So hopefully this is going to stimulate a lot of conversation. Okay, so we do have a number of questions here. First one here from Raquel Moreira. Is the owner of a system a person or department? And what is the system owner's responsibility?
Yeah, so what we found is that it has to be owned by a single person, each system. Now you can have a similar system throughout an organization, and you might have to have, if you've got multiple sites, you need to have an owner at each site. But there needs to be somebody who owns the system. It can't just be some thing out there that nobody is responsible for. Somebody has to take responsibility for it.
Great. From Eric Olson. Good morning, Eric.
Hi, Eric.
Does the Toyota Kata incorporate some of the tools in a system? And again, he uses the example of making those direct connections between direction, current state, current challenge, next experiment, and reflection.
That's a great question. I hadn't thought about that one. But to the extent, so the type of system we would look at is something like a training system, okay? And Toyota Kata could be part of the way of implementing the training that happens. I think that's probably the most common way that Kata would be used, as described in the Toyota Kata book, is within a training system. So we would look at it as there is a certain Kata for a certain function within an organization, and it might be different for Kata in a different way. And that would be different standard work for different things you're trying to teach through the training system. But I hadn't thought of trying to mesh the two together. I would think of Kata as being something that belongs in a system as part of the work that is done there.
Excellent. Thanks, Ken. Cynthia Kumar Mutasami is asking if you can provide some additional guidelines for level production. Hi, Junka. as it relates to the Shingo approach?
So Heijunka and Heijunka is really a way of leveling the flow in an organization. And so you don't have disruptions and up and down. So we find it's impossible to have a good flow without it being somewhat based upon at least the pull of the market. So whether you use tack time, which we recommend as in terms of at least a supporting concept, is you organize your production in such a way that it's leveled out, and that you try to create a partnership with the people that you're supplying so that you can do that leveling. But yes, it's all of the principle that guides that would be flow. And if you can create the proper kind of flow in response to pull, then you can have, you're improving your flow and pull. So yes, that's, it ties to the principles, and that we organize that in terms of, so, or how we would teach it would be in terms of flow and pull.
Excellent. Eric, again, is it constancy of purpose or constancy of values and principles? And can purpose change or be system specific? Eric's trying to catch you here, Ken.
Yeah, I know. And he's, you know, he's been around longer than I have. So, you know, he knows what he's talking about. What we found from our research is even constancy of purpose is insufficient. If the purpose of an organization is simply to make money for the owners and shareholders, and there's no stake or no benefit that comes back to the employees, then people get really tired of that really quickly. And the purpose has to be something that is meaningful to the people in the organization, such as we save lives, as an example, or in the case of OC10, or we recognize great work. And you can go to anybody in either of those organizations and ask, why are you here? And they will answer it in, I came here because I can make a difference because we recognize great work, or I make a difference because I save lives. So it's not just constancy of purpose. It has to be a meaningful purpose, and there has to be some unity of the people within the organization around that purpose. So it's not just constancy, but it's unity and it's meaningful. And so I get, you know, we use it because Deming used it. It's the first of Deming's 14 points, and we're trying to build on Deming's work in the model very deliberately and you know, give credit where credit is due for Deming initially identifying you need to have a constancy of purpose. But there is more to it than just constancy of purpose, which is something that we would, you know, we think is useful to teach as you teach that principle.
So another question here from Eric, which kind of builds on what you just talked about, and that is, what is the connection between know why and purpose?
You need to know your purpose as one of the things you need to know why, but you also need to understand flow and pull. You also need to understand respect every individual. And frankly, we found most of the Shingo Prize recipients early on understood the five principles of continuous improvement. Where they really failed to create the engagement was not respecting people. That's why one of the ways that we recorded in the research we did was the description of we do lean with our people, we don't do lean to our people is the difference of respecting everybody else's opinion and engaging them in the process, creating that kind of culture and doing the things that enable that kind of culture was a big difference in what we found in the organizations that were able to sustain and get better after receiving the Shingo Prize versus those that received the Shingo Prize and then declined in their performance levels.
So somewhat different question here from Dallin Taylor. So can the management systems be the same as company departments, such as the example you used of a purchasing system, which is, you know, in many organizations that might also be, it may be correspond directly to a department?
No.
Would you like to elaborate?
No. No. A system is accomplishing a purpose. A department is there from an organizational structure point of view. But a system is almost always something that is cross-departmental and it's interdependent with other systems and so on. And so it's a different thing within an organization than a department would be.
Okay. So on this next question from Diane Miller, and I think perhaps what I'm also going to do is maybe have Diane provide some additional context on this, because this is very, this next question is really unique to a particular organizational context. But the essence of the question is, within my organization, which is in the hospital hospital systems, how would I measure a change in culture or measure behavioral change? We can easily measure outcomes from results. We're also measuring compliance to tools and systems, but the challenges with culture and behaviors. And perhaps, Diane, if you're there, maybe I can have you sort of follow up to provide a little bit more context that would help Ken in responding to that question.
Let me give an example, though, and while she's answering, okay? So the pandemic has given us a wonderful opportunity to look at the behaviors within hospitals. I mean, talk about having a microscope on you the last year and 4 months or so or more. We've been able to really look deeply into hospitals and the behaviors that happen within hospitals. And we see good hospitals that are protecting their people in the midst of a pandemic and have all the resources they need to provide a safe working environment for the people in the hospital. But we have roughly 130,000 healthcare workers who were infected by the virus during the pandemic at work. And there's a lot of organizations that were not successful at keeping their people safe. And there's a lot of them that didn't pay any attention to it. And I don't know if you saw the instance from the hospital in Washington State, where one of the doctors came out and said, they don't care about us. And they don't provide us with the materials we need, the resources we need to be safe. And then they turned around and fired him for speaking out about the unsafe work environment. And so you have great examples where some hospitals kept their people safe. There's one hospital in the heart of New York City where they had one recorded transfer of the virus to one of the healthcare workers in the hospital. One in the whole hospital in the midst of the worst part of the pandemic that we saw during the whole time, and they kept their people safe. And you compare that to, you get fired for complaining about unsafe work environment. It really polarized the, are we keeping our people safe and do we care about the healthcare workers, the people who are providing the healthcare to the people who are sick? So what kind of behaviors do we look for? There's an example of a behavior, a hospital that cares about their people and keeps them safe versus a hospital who doesn't care and does not keep them safe.
Diane, perhaps you can chime in here and maybe add to what Ken has said or provide some additional context to frame the conversation.
Looks like Diane is on now. So let's see what else she can say.
So I think that was a great example that you had there of the outcome could be the number of staff infected with COVID. So that's an outcome measure. I just find it a little bit harder to measure the principles and behaviors around that. So respecting our individual. As a third party coming in, it would be easy for a consulting firm to come in and observe it, but it is easier for the leaders themselves to maybe self-reflect. We just have a harder time measuring that level of respect.
Well, but you can measure a number of behaviors associated with the outcome you want. So if you have a clear goal of keeping your people safe, you can look at the behaviors and you know what happens if somebody happens to get to have caught it or other things that you now can go back to a little more normal. You know, how many needle pricks happen or how many staff infections get spread through the hospital or things like that are pretty common in healthcare facilities. And then you can look and see what are they doing about it. And that's the doing part, that's the behavior part that drives those ideal results. It's the ideal behaviors drive ideal results. And those are observable no matter what workplace you're in. And so you've got to think through what are the behaviors that are going to drive the outcomes you want.
Thanks for that, Ken. And thanks for thanks for the question, Diane. Great yep. question.
It is a great question.
So this next question actually builds very nicely off the theme that we're just on right now, and it's the issue of lean safety. So Jose Carlos Sa is asking, from what I see in the Shingo model principles, clearly lean safety is huge. Does that mean that I will never succeed in lean without safety?
Yes, you will never succeed in lean without safety. That's what it means. You cannot show respect to your people and get them engaged if you have an unsafe work environment. We have found that true everywhere. We have found the reverse example. A lot of organizations have started with safety as the first thing they drive excellence in. And then that has blossomed into getting people engaged in other areas of improvement outside of safety. So once they feel safe, they can focus on improving the quality of the product, or they can focus on unifying around a purpose, or they can focus on how can we create better flow through the production process or something like that. The safety enables so many other things, and it's a great place to start. But if you have an unsafe work environment, all you want, people will only worry about them being safe. You'll never get excellence in any other area.
So two questions here, Ken, that are really on the same theme of managing change. So let me go ahead and sort of give you both the questions and maybe how you respond to them, at the same time. So Carlos Garcia is asking, what does the Shingo model say about resistance to change? And Ahmad Kasane is asking, can you provide some tips on how to lead change based on the Shingo philosophy?
So change is all about improvement. What you want to change is some way to improve the organization, right? And what you want to be able to teach your students to do is, how do you teach them to make that change? Teach them all how to be experimenters. Teach them the scientific method. Teach them what kind of, you've got to have a standard that you base on. You've got to have a hypothesis that you want to test out. You test it. If it works, great. If it doesn't work, you can improve your standard work because you found something that works better. If you found that it doesn't improve anything, then you've learned, that doesn't help, or that makes it worse. You've learned something. So the worst thing that happens from every experiment that you run is that you've learned something. The best thing that can happen is you make some improvement. But what do we say about resistance to change is, don't experiment, try, encourage people to try, help them. If you have a problem, figure out how to solve it. And you can go test a whole bunch of things. And we as leaders need to be able to provide them with the resources to be able to go experiment and test things, and then support them if they come up with ideas that actually make things better. We need to teach our students, when we're teaching in a classroom, how to become good experimenters. How can they learn from the experiments they run? So.
Great. So I just want to jump down. I just want to sort of comment on, a comment that Diane just made and follow up to the conversation about safety. I think she makes a very important comment here about the importance of psychological,
yes,
not just physical safety. And I think one of the things we've particularly seen over this last year, it is that psychological safety, sense of well-being, which has been critical.
And that's why I use that example of the person being fired. His physical safety as a doctor was not ever in question, but what kind of a message do you send to your people when somebody speaks out on behalf of everybody in the organization who is feeling unsafe and gets fired for it? What kind of psychological safety does anybody have? And the answer is none. And so, yes, it's the psychological safety is critical part of creating the right kind of culture that enables improvement.
So I think we have time for about maybe one or two more questions. So here's another question from Raquel Moreira. What's the real value of leader standard work to executives? Do you have any guidance on the value of this to leaders?
It's this is one where I've gone through a personal evolution and trying to be a good lean leader for the 30 years that I was running corporations before joining the faculty at Utah State and getting involved with the Shingo Institute. My initial leader standard work was a daily Gemba walk. And, I had kind of a checklist of things I did every day. But the most important one was I walked through our plant every day when I wasn't traveling. So, and I could tell just from the way we had the plant set up, I could walk out there and listen. And I could tell how well things were running that day. It was part of my cadence. It was part of my standard work. And I had a couple of other things that I did every week and things I did every month and so on. I find that I've evolved since then. And I find that my standard work now is more driven by the needs of the people that I work with. And I'm a better leader when I am doing the things that support them on their schedule than them doing things to support me on my schedule. And so I find that as a good leader, as I've developed as a leader, I am responding to pull much more than I am forcing people to adhere to my top-down way of doing leader standard work. So there's just a thought for you, Raquel. I don't know if that helps or not.
Well, and I think your response on that one, Ken, actually also speaks to the next question that we have, which again is, this is Atticus Rotoli is actually talking about, in response to Dan's question in a hospital setting about measuring cultural behavior, the importance of in-person observation. So I think you've talked about the importance of it. Can you maybe add anything there in terms of specific things, measurables, outcomes that you might want to include as part of that walk around that might help drive process?
So, and this is one thing we try to teach, and it's hard to do in a classroom setting. And so this is something that's very difficult to do within a university class. Let's just put it that way. But if to the extent you're able to go study organizations in the area where you happen to have students. So it's something that maybe you can do as a club or do as a class activity, but go and observe, but don't go to observe know-how. Don't go and observe to see results, which is what most people do on their go and observe activities, is they go and they look and see how things are going. They look at the chart and say, oh, numbers are good today. We're on schedule, or we're 10 minutes behind schedule or whatever. They go to look at results. That those are all lagging or irrelevant, mostly irrelevant. What you want to go and observe, and what takes a trained eye to be able to go and observe, are the behaviors of people. Are people trusting each other? Are they acting on that trust? Are people well-trained? Are they acting on that training? Are people, and as you observe behaviors, you can understand the organization a lot better. And that takes a more skilled eye. It takes more time. It takes, as my friend Nitsuo Shingo, the son of Shigeo Shingo, often says, you need big eyes and big ears, but not a big mouth. It's a great place to stop.
it is, and it reminds me of another similar saying which says you have two ears and one mouth. You should, at a minimum, use those proportionately, if not maybe even disproportionately relative.
Exactly.
Great. Well, I appreciate you taking the time this morning, Ken. I appreciate all the very good questions that have, allowed Ken to sort of elaborate on some of the themes that he's talked about. Again, to those of you who joined us this morning, again, appreciate you taking the time to spend with us this morning. You know, I think there's a lot of content here embedded within the Shingo approach. Obviously, we all teach Lean in very different ways, but having a underlying framework gives us, for those who are not involved in teaching Lean in the classroom, gives us a good starting point, gives us a good framework that we can build from. Again, I want to remind you to join us again on July the 13th night at 10 in the morning. And again, we will have Ahmed Deef from Cal Poly San Luis Obispo talk to us about how we might use games as a pedagogical tool in support of the Lean education effort. So with that, thank you, everybody. Have a wonderful Tuesday, and we'll see you
on the 13th. Thanks, everybody.